Yeah, I think we are good to go.
It has to come on this side, so function.
No, it will come out again. Yeah, I think. Yeah. Okay. So welcome back after lunch session. So we will now talk about the technology. How do we really make the transistors? We have Professor Sundar Iyer from Department of Electrical Engineering, IIT Kanpur. He will be talking, giving you overview of IC fabrication. Professor.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Yogesh Chauhan. Hope you have been having a good time at IIT Kanpur. I understand there are also some international students here, so that's wonderful to have you people here. Welcome to Kanpur and welcome to India. So let me get started. Considering the theme of the topic, this may be one lecture where you can afford to doze off. If you feel a little drowsy after the heavy lunch, please feel free to do so. Nothing will be lost. You have your notes. But what I also suggest is, if you are awake, I will welcome you to just gather some of the key aspects of it. Clearly, in 1 hour, it's not expected that you will have all the nitty-gritty of the application. But some philosophical aspects which I will try to mention, some broad aspects, which guides us in the way, in the direction we are going in terms of fabrication. I'll just want to highlight those. Essentially, this is the outline of what I will be talking. First, it's good to touch upon a little bit of history, how it evolved. All of you are familiar with it. Even if you are familiar with it, it's good to hear it from another perspective and sometimes reinforce some ideas. Then I want to bring up one important aspect. What is it that motivates us to scale? Why should you make smaller and smaller transistors? So there may be multiple reasons, but other reasons will focus on the fabrication reason, the economics of it. Then I have some slides on the CMOS process flow. I don't think I'm going to too much detail because one can spend a lot of time discussing that. But I just want to highlight that what is essentially happening. There are various sub-processes and we're just bringing them together in sequence, maybe even repeating it a couple of times at various points in the sequence, and then you end up making a complete device. So that's what this is trying to highlight. And the planar process aspects of it, I would like to mention. And then some developments and some changes that have happened have really made things very different from what we ever imagined. So let me touch upon at least some of the ideas. There are many more ideas, but I'll just touch upon some of them. So the history of development of ICs. IC stands for integrated circuits, as all of you know. Now, the birth of electronics, if you think of it, is only around 110 years or so, 140 years. 1904, 1906, that's when the diode and the triode were invented. And the diode and the triode totally revolutionized a lot of things. Diode suddenly made AC, you could convert it comfortably into DC. It was behaving like a rectifier. You could use it as rectifiers and many other applications as well. And then another thing is the triode, which was behaving like a switch. And suddenly what they found out, and thanks to the mathematics, a lot of it was developed already, and some of it was developed by the people who were involved, you could use circuit tricks and you could actually amplify signals. So that was the birth of electronics. But if you look at what ended up achieving it, they were actually vacuum tubes. The reason it was vacuum tube, if you remember your physics and some of the things that you might have read, a lot of work was going on understanding the nature of material itself, atoms, electrons, and suddenly the vacuum tube was in fashion. Okay, and one of the things that is still lingered on is probably our fluorescent tube. That is the type of thing that you evacuated it, maybe filled it with certain gases, then applied voltages and saw what happened. So this vacuum tube were rather bulky, and it would be the size of your palm of your hand if there was a good manufacturer, somebody who was skilled in the art. But so that means that when you're building circuits, things can become a table foot, if I may say. And to put it in perspective, if you wanted to build a computer, the computer idea was something that people had in mind. Bully tried it from the mechanical gears and levers and so on, about a century back. Then there were people who talked about digital electronics, based on that, they wanted to build something that would do a lot of computation and logic analysis for you. And one of the result of that was, just after the World War, they came up with this ENIAC, Electronic Numerical Integrator and Computer. That's what, and so ENIAC was the computer that was built in 1946. And it occupied a full room, actually the size of this room, and really huge, with large number of vacuum tubes. The biggest challenge was often to make sure that it continued to run all the time. Because there was so much current flowing, that invariably what would happen is some wire would melt, some disconnection would go off, rats would come and manipulate the wires, and you find that you are all the time debugging. Okay, so that's how even the term debugging comes, removing the bug. Bug was some insect or something that you ended up messing up the circuitry. The main purpose of this, what the US Army was using, was to predict the projectile trajectory by taking the wind speeds and various other parameters. Quickly to be able to run this, calculate it, and send it to somebody in the field. Wireless communication was certainly there. And then they would actually make the artillery go in the right direction. That was the purpose of this. And what I understand is never got used. And another factor to remember is, besides the bulkiness of this, it required almost a dedicated power plant to run this. So it's several hundred kilowatts it will end up using. So it was certainly not a convenient thing for communication, for all the electronic applications that we imagine today. It was not even imagined at that time. Okay. Now, so people were coming to see, one of the main reasons is you're reading thousands of these. This is a few centimeters in size. If you can reduce it by 100, the whole thing is likely to stay. So why don't we try? So people have been trying it for a long time, how to make what we call as solid state electronic devices. So these are vacuum tubes. You didn't want those gases and rarefied areas and all that, just a solid material. So that's when the transistor invention, in a way, the phenomenon was discovered, and then they realized what it was, and then they made it into a transistor. Thanks to this gentleman who ended up bringing the physics of it, and this gentleman actually ended up doing bench-taking experiments. So in germanium, they found that somehow, under some conditions, it behaved like a triangle. And that was the birth of the solid-state device, solid-state electronics. Now, this evolved, and you have various components. Even today, if you want a transistor, you can buy something, and it's easily available. And you can also put it together on a breadboard. So clearly, this is a far cry from that room full of vacuum tubes. Certainly, it seemed much better. But still, it was not cutting it. Because while soldering, something it can go wrong, and not just that, if you wanted to make one material, it takes time to do it. You cannot have that much throughput. Remember that if you want to make something used by a large number of people, you need a lot of throughput. The speed at which you manufacture becomes an issue. It's not about ease of manufacture. How fast you can manufacture, that's also an important thing. So clearly this was not working out in the direction that people were wanting. A lot of people were keen on doing things. And that's when, in two of the companies, they were trying to see, instead of making one device, ultimately these devices are earlier connected in circuits. And invariably, many of these circuits are repeated. See, what is the advantage of sticking to the device? You can make any circuit with it. If you have a large number of devices, you can make any circuit that you want. But it turns out that even in the circuits, there are some standard circuits you keep repeating. And some of them are very critical. For example, the amplifier circuit has to be designed very carefully. And once it is done, you would like to have many of them. And once you have multiple amplifiers, you can actually do a lot of other interesting things. So they ended up creating, putting together some devices, and when they were making a device in one go, as they were fabricating it, they went ahead and made a complete circuit. So it's the one device you're actually making a lot of devices in one go, but they're also connected in a particular way to form the circuit. So that was the birth of the integrated circuit. Now, interestingly, while what I can say is the success of electronics is purely because of integration. The solid state and all is fine, but the only reason electronics is proliferated is the ability that it brings to integrate things, and in one shot you make it. And when you make it in one shot, a lot of advantages come along with it. First of all, the cost goes down. Instead of making all of them and collecting, when you are doing that process is painstaking, you need to have individuals involved. Even if you bring maybe some robots or something, still, the fact that you have to integrate them, that's a painstaking process, and that the yield gets a hit. The number of successes that you are likely to get reduces, so you have to slow down, so the throughput gets a hit. Not just that, once it is made, it turns out that many of the junctions that you have, the connections that you have, they hardly come in contact with the rest of the world in practice. But the fact that you made it on a breadboard or a PCB, printed circuit board, those contacts are available to the outside world. So, to the temperature and all sorts of variations, maybe somebody ends up knocking off something. So, you find that the error during, as you use it, the lifetime also comes down. So, it turns out that the fact that they put it in this form suddenly was a big boom. This is an example of a amplifier that they have built by Motorola well after these gentlemen had did their circuit in their respective companies. Now you can imagine, once you have an amplifier which is in a small chip, immediately a large number of applications just jump out. A good example that I like to give is somebody wants to use a hearing aid. Now imagine if you want to build an amplifier with vacuum tubes. It will be a big suitcase, right? Or even bigger than a suitcase. Even if you use a PCB, it will be a big piece of board. And not just that, the voltages that you have involved, you don't want to have much higher, you will need a big power source, it becomes tricky. On the other hand, once you have an amplifier that is so small, maybe a couple of millimeters or maybe even a centimeter by centimeter, it can be put into a package and discreetly put inside the ear. So suddenly you find a lot of people are willing to use it also. See, many times people will not want to say that they are not able to hear properly, especially elderly people who might have had hearing issues. They will not want to publicize that. So here you are discreetly able to put it in the ear and use it. This is just one example. There are many, many examples that you find that you could start doing in communications and various other places. You could start using it. So this integrated circuit really changed the way things worked. And what is interesting is this was not realized at that time. Because people, of course, these companies are invested and they saw the benefit and they are using it for their own purpose. But the enormity of their contribution was not recognized at all. So what is interesting is this invention got a Nobel Prize pretty fast. I think the 50s they ended up getting it. This idea that you can put the whole thing together and form an integrated circuit, guess when it was recognized? It also got a Nobel Prize. And luckily it got a Nobel Prize. I'll say why. Anybody knows? 2000. And actually, Jack Kilby got the Nobel Prize that year. And he was a typical engineer, very humble, he totally unassuming, and probably he never even proclaimed, or maybe I don't know, even in his mind, he was not even thinking he had done something so remarkable. So the thing was, he got the Nobel Prize because he was the only person alive. And Nobel Prize can be given only people who are alive. So it turns out that well after the invention, in 2000, it was recognized. And that's a very important aspect. In fact, there are lots of examples you can see, even in displays, for example, the reason the LEDs are invented long time back. So why is it that the flat panel took so long to come? That was because we could not integrate it. Red, green, and blue. If you have to have a very small, say, one pixel, every pixel should have red, green, and blue. And your TV screen with a large number of pixels. It's very difficult, and the yield will be very much. So no way are you going to be economically viable. So integration is the key. And that is what this whole thing is. Now, after this, there was no looking back. Once they said that you could actually build a complete circuit in it, people started doing all sorts of things. Then it has kept on going forward, and the latest incarnation, if you will, is the system on chip. You're not just building one circuit here. You're building multiple circuits, doing multiple things with various types of technologies, and you're putting them all in one chip. So the system on chip is a very unique thing, and especially for space applications and various other places, it continues to be an important aspect. Now, let's quickly take a look at what's happening. So in the 70s, early 70s, Intel was one of the first off the block. It started building microprocessors. Okay. And they came up with a simple microprocessor with 2300 transistors. And that was operating at around 108 kilohertz. Today, for today, if you think about it, it seems really slow because we're talking of gigahertz and hundreds, thousands of gigahertz with optical systems and so on. So now here, they have used 10 micron technology. It was a wonder in itself. Because 10 micron is roughly 1/10 a human hair's width. So if you think about it, something that you cannot see, even then it was a technological wonder. But even when, if you see that, by today's standard, this seems trivial, because if you look at it, 2300 transistors. The example that I like to give is 1000, if you think about it, how long does it take to count 1000? If I count one every second, it will take around 1000 seconds. Correct? So that means if I continuously count, it will take me around 18 minutes or so, around 20 minutes it will take to count 1000. So 2300 transistors, even to count, will take you almost an hour, right? Now, supposing you want to design that, you notice that there is a big challenge. How are you going to put them together? How are you going to connect them? How do you make sure that where is the error that is coming when you are applying signals? So, a whole new paradigm had to be created even at that time. But by today's standard, what we have achieved, today actually, we are talking about this. I have given an example of 22 nanometers. I've stuck to Intel for this thing, and I'll mention that a little bit later. And we are talking of 2.33 gigahertz. Okay, so a significant increase in speed, more than 1000, and the size is 22 nanometers. So again, almost a factor, three orders of magnitude smaller in size. Now, how many transistors does this have? This has about a 1 billion transistors. 1 billion is how much? 10 to the power 9. Of course, I'm talking of the US system of counting, which is even now being used even in Britain. Not a million million, but 1000 million is a billion. 10 to the power 9. How long will it take to count 1 billion? It turns out it will take 36 years. Okay, to count up to 1000 will take you around 20 minutes. To count up to a million will take you around 11 to 12 days just to count. I think about circuit design, putting them together, shifting and putting it there in the right place, even for layouts, and so on. You can see the amount of complexity. And 1 billion, we are talking about 36 years just to count it. Okay, just on the side, that's one reason when we say population of a country is around a billion, it's a big number. Okay, if you want to give respect and value to each individual, so it's a big number. Now, what I'm trying to tell is the complexity of this is enormous, and that is where we stand today. And what they have done is they are trying to divide and conquer and so on. And there's also something that you notice, they're calling a quad core. Essentially, what they're doing, instead of one core processor, they're using four of them. And sometimes they even time multiplex, so you end up getting multiple, as though multiple processors are doing things together. So you are, although they want to actually make it faster and pack much more, they are achieving it by other tricks at the higher level. Instead of one chip, you are using multiple chips, or you are essentially putting four chips in one thing and you are trying to use it. Now, this is a snapshot of Intel's progress. So you can see it was around 1000, and around 2016 they announced 8 billion. It's mind-boggling if you look at the complexity involved and how did they do it? And if you look at it just like that, it means makes no sense. It's something black magic.
one aspect, but the reality is it's all about systematically working towards something, and behind that is a strong support of technology, and we'll try to take a look at that. Now, if you look at CMOS, one of the things that has happened is devices become smaller and smaller. We saw 10 micron when they started, Intel started. But then 2012, 22 was achieved, 14 and so on. And 7 nanometer is what is being done today. In 2018, Huawei and Apple, their product is using 7 nanometers for the transistor size. Now, this is another mind-boggling thing, the 7 nanometers. I want to make a couple of points. First is, 7 nanometers is extremely small. What is the size of an atom? Roughly? Angstrom unit. You are right, your units are correct. It turns around a fraction of an angstrom. So that means you are only talking about a few thousand atoms or molecules that are placed there. That's really a small number, because the number of atoms and all typically per centimeter square is 14 or so. Or 10 meter cube, 10 to the power 22 or so. So in that, I am talking about 10 to the power 3. So the technological progress that has happened is remarkable there. I want you to note that aspect. The other point also I want to mention here, this is not so technical, so I am making a personal comment here. The reason 7 nanometer was not mentioned in the list is because Intel, in some sense, maybe they are delayed the coming of that 7 nanometers, or maybe they have decided not to do it. I don't know what the strategy is. And what is very heartening is, which company has made this? TSMC. To me, it is very fascinating, and for the people sitting in this room, I think it's something worth noting. An Asian company has simply superseded all the other. If I remember TSMC when they started in the 80s and 90s when they started doing back in the thing, they said we will also fabricate some of the things, some of the devices which others don't want to pass because it's too old, their profit is not sufficient. They started doing it. But today, they are leading. Intel has given a global company has delayed it, and this company has succeeded. So I think that's something that shows the determination and the system to develop. Things can be done. So it's amazing they are doing it, and people are also talking about 5 nanometer devices, and people are even talking about molecular transistors and all. But how to achieve it, how to make sure that there is a challenge? Remember one thing, when we are talking about this fabrication, we are talking about a large number. We are talking about maybe 10 to the power 12 transistors or so being fabricated and so on. Now, the variation in the performance of each of these transistors should be within a very narrow range. All of you know that when you are designing a circuit, you are expecting 10% variation. If the threshold voltage has to be 1 volt, at most you will tolerate 1.1 to 0.9. So that means all the transistors, and preferably it will be narrower. When the manufacturer does it, he makes it narrower so that the probability of something lying outside it is extremely small. So there is a lot of rigor and discipline that is involved in this. So if the size becomes close to the molecular level and atomic level, a lot of the standard structures that we have, even the whole statistics that we have, breaks down. We have, rather than doing an implantation, I'm able to say what is the profile of the ions that are present inside. You find it will make more sense because the statistics is no longer valid. It's like saying if 1,000 people are there, you can talk about statistical behavior. If 5 people are there, the statistical behavior is not predictable. If one person is there, you will know less predictable, right? So that's the challenge that is happening as we are going forward. So today, Intel, this is one of the best things that they are doing. But besides that, there are many complex systems also that are built. Here is an example that various parts of a chip is actually a various another component, and they are really coming together and forming a system. And this is Intel's Blue Gene, which ended up beating people in chess and so on. And now today we have supercomputers, which actually occupies huge rooms. So this is not a counterintuitive in the sense that we were saying that we want to make things smaller. Well, we didn't make things smaller for portable electronics. But it turns out, we also need really complex computation. For example, protein unfolding and various other things, prediction of the weather, all sorts of things require intense computation. So in fact, the computations are so huge
It is talking of 10 to the power 17 floating point operations per second. That's what this computer can do. And even this sometimes is not enough to predict, do certain types of simulation. So this is the type of computer that we are building. It is really huge. These are full buildings. And the cooling of this is very important. You can see the air is blown like that, and this is made wider because all the heat has to be dumped. And that's the reason for building these. Why they have become big, the other end has not disappointed us, making things compact and smaller. Today, all of you know that, I can see many of you are already working with your iPhones as we are even talking. So that shows that the power of the electronics that you are having, you have the world in your palm. And not just that, all the information that you have to travel around the world to find, it's all available at click of it. So that's possible because of consumer electronics, and this is, I suppose, one upper end of it that one can talk about. So if you look at what has happened in this whole world, first thing I want to emphasize is the ability to integrate things. But how, integrate what? Smaller and smaller components. Earlier the components were about a few centimeters. First transistor may be a fraction of a millimeter, the antenna, the gate length, the actual device is a handful. Interchip, this may be a centimeter by centimeter, but inside transistor will be 10 micron. It goes on, and today we are at 7 nanometers. Atom is not far away. It's just calling distance. And still people are not giving up. It's amazing how the juggernaut keeps moving. So fundamentals of, but what is interesting is the fundamentals of device continues to be the same. So a lot of what we are learning is based on the fundamentals that are developed in the 50s and 60s. The same physics is valid. Physics may not be valid here. I don't know. Things are changing like that. Even the mathematics, statistics, everything will change. But at least as of now, the same physics and other things are valid. Of course, look at certain effects. A good example of that, all of you know, is the short channel effect. What was not valid in this region, you have to start thinking about it now. So those things you have to incorporate, but basic physics is the same. Now, if you look at what happens, what enables it all? Although this is in terms, you have drawn the triangle inverted as though this is small, but what I'm trying to indicate is, if the material is available, you can make a lot of devices. If the technology and handling it is available, you can make a BJT, you can make a MOSFET, you can make all sorts of devices. But once a device is available, you can put together at least 10 or 100 of circuits. If the circuit is available, you can put together many more systems. And many more systems, if one computer is available, you can write tens of softwares, hundreds of softwares, and so on. So this is how the value chain goes up. Okay? So in this short course, we will be emphasizing on this aspect of it. Now, this particular integration will involve a lot of the materials aspect and how to handle those. And the emphasis would be to integrate the devices to make circuits. That's what integrated circuit does. So in a sense, the device modeling is extremely critical because that's what helps them to know what to integrate, how to integrate, and so on. So you have to work very closely with the fabrication people in some sense. So that was a general background of what was there. So the take-home points are, number one, integration is extremely important. Devices are really shrunk and they are almost close to the atomic level, beyond which physics is bound to change. Even atomic level is bound to change. Molecules, and after that you come to atoms. Molecules are the properties are expected to remain same. Now, let's see what motivated this scaling. Why should we want to make things smaller and smaller? I think this picture will sort of explain what is happening. When you are fabricating or manufacturing, whatever you do, you can never be absolutely sure everything is happening the way they are. And whatever you do, there will be some error here. It's innovative. That's the law of nature. Okay, you may call it whatever, the various philosophical way terms are there, but that's a fact. Now, that being the case, supposing for the level of, but then also another factor is there that as the technology matures, the number of errors that will happen is much less. For example, if somebody manufactures a house using latest technology, the number of defects that has come is much less. On the other hand, if you are building by hand, the chance of making errors will be much more. For example, these tiles are probably cut with machines. Instead, if you have used a hacksaw to cut,
there will be more jaggedness and more errors, and you'll find you'll be able to detect more. Same thing in fabrication. As technology improves, the number of errors decreases. It's a painstaking task, but it's possible to decrease it. But it will remain all the same. It can simply not be zero. Only when you want to write a project to the government or something like that, you will say, well, anything will be done. But if you look at the reality, there is always, it's a probability game. You maximize the probability of what you can. Now, supposing for a given technology, this is a wafer and these are places where defects are formed. This is not how it forms. Usually, luckily for us, defects always form in a cluster. They don't spread out. But supposing this is how it is. And these are the chips that you are making, integrated circuits you are making based on the size of your transistor. So what do you find? What is the yield of this particular wafer? Yield means what fraction of the possible good chips are actually good? What is the yield in this wafer? 1 out of 4. So 25%. Is this something any businessman want to go for? Unless you are getting a lot of money for that one chip, which is why the prices used to be high, you will not, this it's not a very good venture. So what do you do? What one of the ways what you can tackle this is, you can somehow work to make the devices smaller and make sure that the defect density is similar. So that's where the process engineers are working, trying to increase the ability to pack things more. So if you do that, if you look at this particular thing, you can see the yield is significantly more. It turns out to be around 75% more. You can calculate it. You can work it out by counting it in your handout that is given. So clearly you are able to jump to the 80% yield versus 25%. So here you have, if you keep the price of the chip same, clearly it's a huge win. This company which is able to do this is going to succeed. Not just that, you could even sell it at a slightly lower price to entice more people to use that electronics, and you end up in. That's the reason we are able to get all the mobile phones at such low cost. Okay? And now, one may argue another way also. Instead of making the dice small, can you make the wafer large and process a larger wafer? Certainly. It turns out that is also at play. People are actually doing that. It turns out that earlier when they started making these devices, the diameter of the device wafer was just about an inch. In fact, I have some samples here. Maybe I can show that to you. Yeah. So I'll give you a minute. This I just want to show from far away. So this is a 1-inch wafer. This is how it started. Then you have 1.5 inch. One and a half inch, 2 inch. You notice that I'm saying all this are in inch. The irony is, although US is probably anti-British or whatever it is at the time of independence, somehow they always retained an FPS system. Britain has given up and they are using MKS system, they still use inch. Although luckily in the technical field they do use MKS system. So this is for you, 3 inch wafers, and then I had a 4-inch wafer which I used during my PhD, and then 6-inch I used, it was an industry. So this is an 8-inch wafer. I can share this with you. So you can see this is the finished wafer. This is essentially silicon, which is a huge molecule. The silicon is connected to every other silicon. All silicon is connected to other silicon. It's like a giant molecule in a sense. It's a huge crystal. That you are having. And on this, you get properties which are similar. And the defect density is extremely low. The number of silicon that is not connected properly to some other silicon is negligible, a few per centimeter square. That's really small. And this is a wafer where some devices have been fabricated. So you can take a look. Some of the things that you are talking about, how they will look once a wafer is fabricated. You can please return this at the end of it. But people, because I want to show it to other students. I don't mind. You shouldn't stop there. They talked about this is the size of a wafer in a typical fab today. It's 1 foot across, or 300 millimeters. As I said, now they are using systems that are closer to the MKS. So 300 millimeters is the size of this wafer. Now, when I have to come, I didn't know how to carry it. The manager said, you can show it to your students. So I used the pizza tray to bring it with me. Now, the other thing that you notice here, the 450 nanometer is also available. Now, what is interesting is, why it is available, not many people are taking it up. Why? Again, economics. If you notice, what is the size of a chip, typical chip? It will be really small. Typical chip, I mean, say, is the chip that you need for your box. It will be a millimeter by millimeter. Suppose I use this particular wafer. In one processing, I will get 10,000 odd chips. Okay, and if you have a good process, you will get 10,000 chips per day. So the whole cost of manufacturing is extremely costly. If you say, you have 10,000 rupees, $10,000 you pay. $10,000 is a lot of money for one wafer. And they are produced in batches. So if 10,000 chips are made, each of them is around $1. No wonder that they are able to sell this for a few hundred rupees. So that is why the scale is coming. That having been said, after some time, there will be no economic benefit in making this because you have too much of it. So that means this is a low value, the value chain will come from somewhere else. So that is where they found that 450 nanometers still has not caught on. But maybe with more sophisticated chips and larger area chips, that may come up. So, this particular feature, all of you might remember what we call Moore's law. That's something that you taught. What is happening in Moore's law? Actually, it's not a law, it's more of an observation. Okay, and it's remarkable to see. I would encourage all of you who are in the area of microelectronics, if you are going to pursue in this, I would strongly encourage you to read this paper that is written in this journal. Electronics is the name of the journal, and 1965. Such clarity of thought that I want us to see to believe. In the sense that at that time he is talking about personal computers, communication devices, and it's remarkable. Now, he was able to see there were three generations of fabrication that happened in Intel. They were clearly trying to pack more and more so that the cost of their single die will come down. And they are able to make more dies and more complex circuits for the same cost or lower cost. So he looked at three of them and immediately he was able to see what is happening. He realized that as this technology develops, you are able to make larger and larger dies which are without defects. So as a result, there is a minima that you are finding the larger number of devices you are able to make in one go. And the cost is actually dropping. So he was able to predict what is happening, and that's where he comes up with the theory that every generation things are going to double. At that time, the generation was 3 years, every 3 years. And then with technology, almost on a runaway process, I would say, positive feedback almost, you find that every 1.5 years it starts improving. Till it hit a roadblock around the early 2000, when the heat dissipation was too much. And that's when the problems came and things started slowing down a little bit. But still the march is on. They're going on backing more and more. So this is how Moore's law is coming about. And I will encourage all of you, at least sometime, if you are going to be even remotely connected to microelectronics, look at this paper. This should be, the details should be available to you in your handout. Then of course, Moore's law clearly shows that in increases, you must have seen this, how it keeps packing, and I showed you in another form here. Now, the chip is just one aspect. Actually, there are two other aspects that are also taking a lot of progress is happening. Besides that, you need interconnects, and you are facing some peculiar challenges. Interconnects are to connect smaller and smaller chips next to each other. That means they have become even smaller and they are extremely reliable. Interconnects are extremely reliable. They are communication medium between devices. But besides that, the chips are also becoming bigger because of the complexity. Earlier, a typical chip was maybe a fraction of a centimeter by fraction of a centimeter, maybe 1 centimeter by 1 centimeter. Today, some of the most sophisticated systems that some of you may be knowing or maybe working in the future, they are typically of the order of a couple of centimeters by a couple of centimeters, and inch by inch. That means the interconnect has to run across the full length of the chip, communicating and keeping the time diagram and so on. So you find there are two parts of it. Some of the interconnects become very small with various technologies, smaller and smaller and smaller. And you also have longer and longer and longer interconnects. So interconnect technology is a very important aspect. If you are interested in technologies in the area, you will find that there will always be a good business and you will always get a job in it. So that is about prediction, and it's remarkable how some people are able to see it. And once you see something with clarity, you can start making use of it, you can invest money and make your funds come to it and so on, and then it keeps moving forward. But then what is it that fundamentally made it possible? This is not something that made me, puzzled me quite a bit, but when I put, this is some ideas that I have put together, you are welcome to critique it, debate it and so on, and if you have some other ideas also, I am welcome to share. One of the reasons that has happened is, by 1950s, 1960s, technology really had improved. To give a simple idea, you could do temperature control with great precision, fraction of a degree centigrade. You may wonder, what is the big key? If you think about it, other than 100 degrees centigrade, why? Because of boiling of water. In cooking, we use it all the time. Okay, nature's thermostat is 100 degrees centigrade, water boiling and it remains at that point. So typically 100 degrees centigrade is what, other than that, most of the temperatures you could not precisely control. But with development in controls, development in technology and so on, they were able to precisely control temperature, vacuum. They were able to go to really low vacuums. That means contamination is less. Only the gases that you are introducing into the chamber, only those gases are there. So the defects that are going to form because of some other gas molecule getting in the way and form of some other reaction, all that significantly reduces flow rates, environment control. So a lot of technological advancement had happened. We were able to look at it, control even at the atomic level. Some of you may be aware, when atomic model was proposed, nobody had seen that. The Plum-Pudding model that is almost similar, right? Solar system like model and so on. Nobody saw the atom. They were just bombarding with alpha particles and trying to predict what it was. And based on that, models had come up. And interestingly, that stood the test of time and they were able to build on it. Eventually, when they actually looked at it, they were only recently, in the 80s or so, when comfortably one was able to look at it, using T, cross-sectional T, using AFM. AFM today, it's a desktop equipment. You can get it in very conveniently, you can actually do the surface roughness and how many atoms are present and so on. So that is another remarkable thing. We were able to characterize it. See, you can have sophisticated things, but unless you have feedback, what has happened? I'm not doing it correctly. So to quote one of my colleagues, Professor Mohapatra, he said, the eyes and ears are the technology. So this was provided by us. So this is another big reason why it was possible to achieve our understanding technology. And then, of course, materials has been a strong point. It is something that has been coming over the centuries. But clearly, today, I would say materials plays an extremely important role. And what is interesting is, most of the things that you are viewing in modeling, they are not using the materials that were used, say, for 30, 40 years back. So that is where you have to tweak. Your models and all things are seeing the parameters. For example, metals used to be aluminium. It's now copper. Why? Copper's resistivity is 50% lower. So that means that, or 30% lower, that is, aluminium's resistivity is 50% higher than copper. So what you find is, same circuit, just put copper, it becomes so much faster. Because RC delay, resistivity is the delay. So suddenly you find that, then silicon germanium, you are able to tune the band gap and do certain tricks. You see what they are doing. Silicon on insulator, That's a fascinating thing. Suddenly you find that you have able to remove the capacitances and operating at constant speed, make them in a very small thing, high K, low K. High K because you want very good control of the gate channel. Yeah, and so you are using high K there. On the other hand, you want to pack things slower and closer, so they will be isolated. So the capacitor coupling should be as low as possible. So then you use low K diode. And what is the lowest K that you can use? Vacuum, why M? Okay, vacuum is ideal, but M is 1, right? Interestingly, people are trying to move towards that. Half a material would be to use porous material. If you have porous material with air sacs, so it's like material, some air, material, some air. So clearly the viability concept comes out. But people have used vacuum also, vacuum vacuum air. It's like, if you look at that chip, it is like a freeway. Everything is running with process. Of course, periodically they are controlled, they are held together in place. And then you have those connectors doing it. So they are not, they're interacting, they're excellent, there is one.
So essentially, IC fabrication is all about identifying what you need to do. Then you fabricate, then verify, and you go through in a cyclic manner. So
what I want you to admire is the remarkable technological progress that has happened. And this has to be kept in mind. It is not just one thing makes runaway progress, and that's not the case. Earlier, mathematics was very good endeavor. People had wonderful ideas. People thought that they wanted to fly. That's not all over the world people wanted to fly, right? But it took the technological advancement to be able to do that. And today is unprecedented times when we are able to do that.
So, the next time, I want to be a little brief because you have the material with you. Those who want can go through step by step how to make a CMOS. Now, what is it? What I want to emphasize here is the planar nature of the technology.
The device is a 1-dimensional, 2-dimensional, 3-dimensional, or 4-dimensional, or 3-dimensional. It is 3-dimensional, right? But what is interesting is to define the device, you only use 2-dimensional. That is a strategy that has been adapted. And it has an advantage. You can draw something on a piece of paper, translate it, and communicate, and that's probably one of the reasons it has happened. So the vertical direction is invariably taken to be a constant or standard. It is standardized and told to you, this will be the property you will get for unit area, you go and design. So that's what all the layout and everything does. It's always 2-dimensional. So you have what is known as a planar process. So although the device, as you see, this is a traditional MOSFET, this is the isolation area, source and drain and gate. You actually just look at it from top, define an active area, gate, source, drain. Okay, so we use planar technology. Now, people are always arguing, if I want to put, actually the dimensions you might be knowing, this is one of the things that I like to point out because I found it very fascinating when I put it together to look at the numbers. We said this, so 1 billion, correct? 1 billion to come, if it is linear, it will be 36 years before. Put it another way, if you make it 2-dimensional, if everybody on Earth was to be given, say, 100 square meters of area, it turns out you can put the whole world's population in some, in maybe the three or four southern states, you'll be able to pack it. And each of them will get 100 square meters. Why? From 1-dimensional, they are going to 2-dimensional. You find the packing density is significantly smaller. Now, if you take it further, 3-dimensional, it turns out, if you assume that what is normally believed in the scientific world, the population of the world today is around 6 to 7 billion. If you look at all through history, the total number of people who have ever lived as per our beliefs in the scientific world is around 12 billion. If you put all of them into a cube, what will it be volume? It turns out it's about a cubic mile. Okay, so what seemed to be an intractable problem when you made it in 1-dimensional and that was around 36 years, you just count them and individually look at them and make them stand one behind the other, it is a huge length. When you went for two dimensional, you found it significantly reduced. Three dimensions is so compact. In fact, what they say is, you can put all the people who ever lived on Earth inside Mount Fuji. Mount Fuji is about a mile deep and square mile. So you can actually do it. So that is the interesting aspect of cosmology. So why don't we go for three dimensions? See, we want to pack more and more. So you are trying to make it smaller, linear dimension, you make it smaller. So why don't we go for three dimensions? Anybody? What is stopping us? It's actually the heat dissipation. Mainly it's the heat dissipation, but there are many other problems that come. Two dimensions itself is a problem. You have to access the various circuits. Like three dimensions, accessing each of them, suppose you want to lead from somewhere in the center, it becomes a challenge. So that, but the biggest reason it is stopping us is the heat dissipation. Of course, the fabrication process becomes extremely complex. But that having been said, of late, there have been some flicker of effort by some groups, especially Global Foundries. I know they had a big push for it. IBM before that, they are talking three-dimensional integration. Device size is going on increasing, decreasing, right? 10 nanometers are thing, and that's a driver. So besides the cost aspect, when you make devices small, know that the capacitance is small. So what happens to the speed? RC reduces. What happens to the power dissipation? CV square is the total energy dissipated per switching, right? So it actually decreases. So clearly, shrinking has other advantages. So maybe when we shrink it significantly, we may be able to go up to three dimensions. I don't know. Wafer size is also increasing. So when you talk of device processing, you are talking of typically three steps. Addition, you normally put a layer, then you define it by lithography, and then you etch it. So addition, definition, subtraction. So that's how the whole process is done. So you have layers and layers and layers in three dimensions. Sometimes the layers may be interspersed, you may implant and things like that. But essentially it is this. Today there are other techniques that people are talking about printing. Instead of doing this, especially for technologies such as solar cells, they want to print the electrodes. Why? You don't have to put, define, then remove. In printing, what do? You put only where you want to put the material. So that is some of the newer directions in which we are moving. But in this planar technology, this is the standard process that is considered. You put various materials by oxidation, implantation, deposition, various techniques are there. Each of them is an ocean in itself. A lot of experts have spent a lot of countless hours coming up and developing them. Then you have lithography, and then you have etching. Here also lots of steps are there, and people have spent a lot of effort in that. Now, this lithography, the definition, where is it defined? That is where the IP is for a circuit. Addition, subtraction is standard and same for all devices. The lithography process is also same for all devices. But the mask that you use for lithography, that is actually the intellectual property where the circuit designers work. Okay? So in the planar process, there is a 0.25 micron technology given here. As I said, I will skip it. You are welcome to read it, and if there is any questions, you are always welcome to ask. So typically, you start with the wafer. First step is you define the active area, and then these are isolations. The wafer isolation. Yeah, I have said that you can sleep. I will say that you can start discussing amongst yourself. So may I request discussion before sleep? Sleeping is good. You are actually close to the ultimate degree that is one of the things, Anandamaya Kosha accent. You are actually totally in place. So go to sleep rather than discussing. Okay, so you define the active area. Then what you do is, you do the lithography and you implant where you want. So here you are implanting the well, P well and N well you are implanting. Then you come to a very crucial step where you grow the gate oxide. This gate oxide is extremely critical, it's of the order of 1 nanometer. We just saw what is the size of an atom or a molecule. We are talking a very small number of molecules. Product after product, all of them are uniform. And then you make the gate on top of it and you define the gate. And this gate definition is extremely critical because this tells you what is the technology. 7 nanometers, like I say, it is actually 7 nanometers is the temperature. So then you go ahead and make the source drain implant. What is interesting in the self-aligned process is as you do the implant, the gate material itself blocks it. And only where you want, you get the source and drain. And the gate, you use polysilicon. So N plus if you want to make, in a P well, you want N plus and N plus source drain. The gate also gets N plus, and that is okay. So you have these, and you then you make the angled implant for your halo. This is to prevent short channel effect. And then you make spacers so that you have the shallow drains, and then you have make the proper drains. So here also you make NFET and PFET separately. So notice one thing, the process is same, but the lithography tells where the process has to apply. So the lithography is the designing of the lithography mask is the IND. And that's where all the circuit designers and the layout designers are working. Then following that, you actually put some,
as I said, can I request, is it so difficult? Is it okay? Can we wait till we finish? You can go out. That's okay, huh?
Yeah.
Because it's a small room. It's meant for discussion. Okay.
Yeah. So now you find that.
Hello, Bakarla. Yours is next?
No.
Okay. Yeah. Then you have actually, you put the LPCVD oxide, you isolate them, and then you open some openings to create contacts.
See, you can make the device, but you need to have the contact. Otherwise, what's the come out? So you make that. And here you can put, here you are using tungsten, and then on top of it you use copper to connect it. Okay, so you can take a look at the process, and I think many of you must have done courses in this, so you may be able to quickly read it. But let me wrap up by saying a few decent advances. One of the interesting things is metallization can be multi-level. Earlier, metallization was only one level. The fact that you can go multi-level, suddenly you are able to contact any device to any device. Time out.
Okay. Okay. You can. So this is an example. So here you can see there are only 5 levels, but today there are, we are talking of 14 levels and so on. But see, this is where the device is, and each of these levels are above. So what advantage you have is you can go over each device, so you can, your connection becomes much easier, much more flexible. And this is an example of an 8 level. And when you go to the higher levels, these are thicker because the long distance things are actually put. It's nothing a surprise. If you want the road from Kanpur to Delhi is wide, right? It will always be wide. So long distance is always wider because it has to take a lot more traffic and much faster. Smaller village roads will be narrow. So local roads are always narrower. So you have these pictures. So the various mask steps are involved. So essentially what you do is the whole thing you collapse into simple masks by which you are able to define the device. So let me wrap up with some recent developments. The MOS structure itself is slightly different from what it was 10 years ago, well, not 10, 20 years ago. So you have metals instead of polysilicon. This, of course, happened much earlier. SiO2 has become high-k dielectric today. Silicon has been modified into silicon germanium. And one of the things that they have done is they actually strain the silicon or stress the silicon depending on what you want to do. And that's where silicon germanium comes into play. Silicon has a particular size. Germanium has a different size. So you can actually stress and strain. So you end up actually, for example, here, compressive strain, you are able to improve the hole mobility. And tensile strain, you are able to increase the electron mobility. So you use those to get the extra speed in the transistor. Silicon on insulator, as I said, just putting an insulator underneath makes the device process and structure much simpler. Today, of course, in order to get better control of the channel, they are using FinFETs, and this is the mainstay of today's device, especially the cutting edge devices. And this can be built on SOI as well as on silicon. And finally, one of the latest trends is actually 3D integrations. And this lot of effort is being done where various devices, various chips are fabricated. You take one and after the other, stack them. And the beauty is you can actually cleave these in very thin sizes. So you can actually, the three-dimensional thing will be so thick also. So you're able to do that. And it's almost like a three-dimensional there's some building structure that you can see. Although this lot of effort was being done, I don't think this has really taken off that much, but it's a lot of effort and there's a good chance in the near future we'll be using this. So summary, integrating, main message that I want you to take, integrating circuits is the important aspect. Continued motivation for integration does exist because of lower power dissipation, lower cost. Planar process is the main process today, but it's not in the future, 3D will come. And lots of ingenuity is there, which those who are interested, we can discuss some other time, and I'm sure you can also find out from various sources.
Who's next? We have a tea break.
Oh, tea break. Okay. Oh, sorry. I'm sorry I ate into your.